dear friends. My name is Chatziathanasiou. I will present you here a case of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and I will discuss the ECG, the echocardiographic findings and treatment.
This is the ECG of an asymptomatic man, 65 years old. He has a medical history of mild hypertension and a family history of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. His brother has been diagnosed with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. He denied any family history of sudden cardiac death. He didn't have any history of syncope. On physical examination, he had a blood pressure of 150 to 75 and a systolic murmur. Is this ECG normal? It is an abnormal ECG, although findings are not impressive. The rhythm is sinus, P waves are prolonged. This is more obvious in lead 2. The duration of the P wave is over 3 millimeters, so over 120 milliseconds. And this is an indication of left atrial enlargement. There is a small ST depression in lead 1, V5 and V6. And the slight T wave inversion in lead AVL. So there are mild ST T wave abnormalities in leads that have an orientation towards the left ventricle. There is also a deepest wave in lead V1 with a small ST elevation in the same lead. This pattern in lead V1 can raise a suspicion of left ventricular hypertrophy. The Sokolov index, that is the sum of the R wave in lead V5 and the S wave in lead V1, is about 34 millimeters, which is approximately at the upper limit of normal. The upper limit of normal is 35 millimeters. This also raises a suspicion of possible left ventricular hypertrophy, although it is not a definitive finding. In other patients with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, ECG findings are more prominent, with more prominent ECG signs of left ventricular hypertrophy, more apparent STT wave abnormalities. STT wave abnormalities are the most common ECG electrocardiographic manifestations in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. In hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, prominent Q waves may be present in the inferior and or precordial leads caused by septal hypertrophy. This is the parasternal long axis view. There is an asymmetric hypertrophy of the interventricular septum, which is much thicker than the posterior wall. In this case, the hypertrophy is relatively mild. The thickness of the septum at end diastole was 1.5 centimeters and of the posterior wall 1.1 centimeters. The mitral valve has elongated leaflets with anterior motion in systole. You can see that in systole the anterior leaflet of the mitral valve moves near the interventricular septum. The left atrium is enlarged. Systolic anterior motion of the mitral valve in conjunction with septal hypertrophy causes a degree of obstruction in the left ventricular outflow tract. So this is a case of hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. Obstruction may be present at rest or only with exercise. With color Doppler, there is flow acceleration in the left ventricular outflow tract, proximal to the aortic valve, due to the systolic dynamic obstruction, as indicated by the green color, which depicts high velocity turbulent flow. There is also a jet of a moderate mitral regurgitation in the left atrium. Mitral regurgitation in hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy is the result of the systolic anterior motion of the mitral valve. The arrow points at the systolic anterior motion of the mitral valve, which comes very close to the interventricular septum during systole. On the apical views, notice again the hypertrophy of the interventricular septum, the normal left ventricular contractile function, and the systolic anterior motion of the mitral valve, which approaches the septum on during systole, as shown by the arrow. Continuous wave Doppler through the left ventricular outflow tract and the aortic valve shows a late peaking and increased systolic velocity. In hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, the continuous wave Doppler signal has a characteristic shape like a knife because of its late peak. Here, peak gradient was about 30 mm mercury, which indicates mild obstruction at rest. In general, severe obstruction is present when the peak gradient is over 50 mm mercury. The peak gradient should also be measured immediately after exercise, because sometimes it increases with exercise. These are the pulse wave tissue Doppler velocities of the septal mitral annulus. There is a systolic velocity S, an early diastolic velocity E, and a late diastolic velocity at atrial systole A. Note that tissue Doppler velocities of the septal mitral annulus are lower than the tissue Doppler velocities of the lateral mitral annulus shown here. This difference exists because in this case the pathological hypertrophic myocardium is mainly present at the septum. In general, in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, there is hypertrophy of the left ventricle usually, and less commonly of the right ventricle or both ventricles. Hypertrophy, that is increased cardiac muscle thickness, is inappropriate. It is not expected as a result of an etiologic condition such as hypertension or aortic stenosis, etc. Hypertrophy may be generalized or regional, and it is almost always present by the age of 30 years. Contractile function in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, as assessed by two-dimensional imaging or by the ejection fraction, is usually preserved and rarely reduced. When more sensitive methods are used, such as tissue Doppler imaging or strain and strain rate, indices of contractile function are found to be reduced, but abnormalities are more prominent in indices of diastolic function, such as the early diastolic peak velocity of the mitral annulus by pulse wave tissue Doppler imaging, which is usually reduced. In patients with hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy who have symptoms, treatment to reduce the left ventricular outflow tract gradient is indicated. Such treatment includes beta blockers or verapamil, usually in high doses. If this fails, combined treatment with a beta blocker in a small to moderate dose plus disopyramide, an antiarrhythmic drug with potent negative inotropic properties, is an option. Surgical myectomy, alcohol septal ablation, or DDD pacing are treatment options that act by reducing the left ventricular outflow tract gradient, selected in cases of hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy with symptoms refractory to medical therapy. Risk factors for sudden cardiac death in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy are the following: massive left ventricular hypertrophy over 30 mm on echocardiography, over 3 cm, thickness of the left ventricular wall, family history of sudden cardiac death that has occurred before the age of 50, non-sustained ventricular tachycardia on 24-hour Holter monitoring, prior unexplained syncope, abnormal blood pressure response on exercise. This is a failure of blood pressure to rise or a fall in blood pressure with exercise. ICD, implantable cardioverter defibrillator, implantation should be seriously considered in patients with two or more of these risk factors. When the risk is less, amiodarone is an appropriate alternative. Thank you for watching this video.